I got a couple of these NVMe Thunderbolt drive enclosures from AliExpress because the price was quite reasonable, around $60. And this is actually the good version that's 40 gigabits per second, not some of the other cheap ones that you see, which are only 20 gigabits per second. Only two lanes of the PCIe is used. But what I didn't realize until we got it is that it's only for low profile single-sided NVMe drives, which is quite annoying because I was hoping to put a big drive in it. Let's take a look. Comes with a cable. Quite annoyingly kinked. They should have rolled it nicely. It's got a locking device on it, which is useful. Useful if you can get that screw done up, because there's no slot on it for a screwdriver, so that's quite fiddly. A drive enclosure, a heatsink, some screwdrivers and screw. Bag to put it in. And some instructions on how to put it together. Okay. Is that supposed to be floating around? I guess so. Oh yeah. So that will go over the edge of the drive and then get screwed down. The board's also a bit wonky in there. There's the screw. Okay. There's all the business on the back side of the board. It's got some kind of ceramic feeling heat spreader attached to the top of the Thunderbolt chip, which pushes against this aluminium backing part. Now they've used an unfortunately low profile connector in there. Although, this one doesn't look as bad as the other one that I opened. Oh, that's very surprising. I'm surprised. So I already opened another packet of this and put a drive in it. And this one here has a really low profile connector in it, which is different to this one. And I was about to point out how annoyed I am about the low profile connector, because even this adapter, which turns it into a PCIe slot, cannot fit in this other one that I've already looked at, because the socket on there is so low close to the board that these pins poking out the bottom just clash onto the board and you cannot, it can't go flat. But this one they've put a better connector on. Interesting, so maybe it's a lottery. You're either going to get one that can support thicker drives or not. It'll be a bit difficult to show that, but you probably should show it anyway. So I also got this adapter, which there's a cabled version which goes to a PCIe slot from this, and I was disappointed because it's got these screws sticking out the bottom. When I was looking to buy it, I thought, oh, that's nice. Everything comes off the top, so it will leave the bottom flat, so it will be able to fit on here fine. But no, they put these screw heads there, which unfortunately, even on this one with the raised connector, down in there, the screw head is banging into the top of those tiny little components that are on the back of the board. So that's not really going to work. This one might work though. We're going to try it out soon. I'm also going to do some benchmarking. I've got a 1 terabyte drive to stick in this. But let's have a look in this. I don't particularly want to open it now it's all sorted and closed, but we need to compare the connectors on this. I'll use a proper screwdriver instead of the bad quality ones they give you. Just didn't fit the screw heads very well. So there's 6 screws down the sides, and that holds the bottom and the top plate and the metal band altogether. I also discovered the drives have parts of different heights. So when you go to stick this heatsink on the top of the drive, it doesn't really touch most of the drive. So I got these various thermal conformable pads of various thicknesses and put one of those in between the heatsink and the drive. And then what I realized when the heatsink gets put down, it still seems to be missing the springs. When the heatsink's put down, it just bends the drive against the board, which is pretty rough for it. So instead, I just put the thermal pad on the controller of the NVMe drive, since that's the hottest part. The hope that it'll be good enough. It's better than nothing, I suppose. Okay, so the frame comes off, then the board will come out. Yeah, so that's no good because this one here didn't come with the springs to hold the heatsink down. That you can see here on this one, there are springs, so the heatsink is being pressed against the drive, and you can see in there the edge of a pad. But what you can also see is how flat the connector is right against the board compared to this one, which is taller. Actually, I ordered some taller connectors. And I was going to desolder this one and replace it with a taller one, but yeah, if this works well, then maybe I don't need to do that. I'll just keep this one for a single-sided drive and use this one for larger 4 terabyte drive, which I haven't bought yet anyway. So that's interesting and surprising. So I'll put this back. Oh, it looks like you're supposed to screw that board down. Didn't come with screws to do that, it only comes with the 6 screws to go around the edge of the housing. So when you get it, it comes with this little tab so you can pull the lid off easily. And I pulled that off, but it left a thing. Okay. Let's try some things. I'll put this drive in and do some benchmarking. Also want to put a PCIe card in this and see what happens. Unfortunately, I can't use this one unless I take the screw out. Not really sure what this extra layer is doing. It's holding down the connector and or the cable in some way. But perhaps we should take a look under it and see what's in there. It's just a strain relief. There's nothing visible under there. The soldering is hidden by the tape. It's just a bit of milled out PCB material. Yeah. So I'll be able to have one screw in there to hold this piece together. I suppose we could just glue it on. And that will probably provide better strain relief anyway, because this thing just seems like a bit of a token gesture. It doesn't actually hold the cable down. I think it just stops you from bending it too close to the soldering. So that should be able to fit now without shorting out on any of those parts. And the other screw does still hold. We'll touch the bottom. That's another thing to think about. If this connector is made taller, then this little nut thing which holds the drive down would also need to get taller. Which the one that's in here is short, presumably. Take it all apart again. Yeah, this one's got one that's retained into the board. So I wonder if one of these is newer than the other. That way you might be able to tell which one you're going to get if you order. So there's a sticker there. And there's a number there that's different. 4642, and this one's 4811. Don't know what that means. This date's on the board. This one here says 2018-06-29. So that's old. This one here says 2021-03-30. So that's from this year. Unless they've got heaps of old stock sitting around, you are probably more likely to get this one with the more useful connector. So that's encouraging. Does that mean I've got to buy some more now and see what happens? Now I've lost track of what bit goes where. So it's got a 2 terabyte Samsung drive in it. So this is one of the older ones. Don't know what to do first. I guess we'll benchmark a drive first. That seems like a good idea. Put that in. One of the things I wanted to do was see if it's possible to determine with these drives if the computer I've got has got shared four lanes of PCI Express going to the both Thunderbolt ports, or whether it can offer individual, well, four PCIe lanes to each Thunderbolt port. Since the Thunderbolt controller is built into the CPU with these new 11th generation i7s, in theory it would be able to provide full bandwidth on both ports if it can internally route that sort of thing. Anyway, I don't know if these drives will be fast enough to determine that, but I want to have a go anyway. So we'll hook up two drives, run a test on each, and then we'll try running the test together and we'll see what happens. Okay, let's set up for that. Well, that's a bit annoying. It's getting all ready to do some benchmarking tests. I've got this one here connected right now, and you can see there on the Thunderbolt thing, it shows up. But if you try to join a second one, you get this message saying Thunderbolt device functionality might be limited. Yeah, well, it's actually non-existent. You can only have one of these things joined onto the computer at a time. As soon as you try and join a second one, it doesn't matter which one, I've tried both each one in each of these ports and connecting each one first, and whichever one you connect first, doesn't matter which port, is the one that works, and the other one doesn't work. So there you go. That means we can't do the test. Unless we find another way. And now it'll work out which one. So yeah, this one doesn't do anything, and this buy win one is the one that was working. So now if we replug this Samsung one first, it comes up. So that's the Samsung one there, which loaded up. Which has a protected partition on it, but that's okay. So that shows up, and we plug in the second one, which was connected before. And we get that thing again, and it doesn't show up. So that's annoying. Maybe we can still do a test using a dodgy thing like this, which is a different Thunderbolt to PCI thing, and then use that to attach the drive, and we can do some benchmarking. But yeah, bad news, you can't use two of these things on one computer at the same time. Like, the whole reason I bought two of them was because I wanted to run them at the same time to see what the Thunderbolt bandwidth was like. So yay or unyay. So we've got to change what the drive is mounted in. Found the power supply, it was right there all along. I'm not using that at the moment because it doesn't want to play along with a second one, and we better keep that with it. Otherwise bad things could happen. And this has got its own bracket holder thing. Okay, so we can plug this into here. Power this thing up. And Thunderbolt it up. And hopefully... Ooh. The light came on. Just gonna bring back the other screen. Okay, I think that worked. Right up into our Thunderbolt doofy, find the right thing to move. Okay, so that's just complaining about the... Here we go, so we've got both things hooked up now. So that board, which now you can't see, that board there, Kitio node board. Just some random board that I've got on eBay for fairly cheap, so someone must have taken it out of their node and then sold it for some reason. No idea why, but annoyingly it's the one that doesn't have the second Thunderbolt port in it. So we're going to benchmark some drives. So now the next problem is going to be, can we run two instances of this program on the different drives? Looks like we can. I'll probably make this quite big so that the test lasts for a while. Is that a good idea? Maybe. So what do we got here to play with? F and H. F will be the one that's in the case, and H will be the one that's on that wear board. Okay, let's try the one that's in the case first. Does it do anything? I suppose it's got to write the temporary file first. Okay. I don't know. That's this one. I think it has a light. I thought it would be testing away merrily, but that doesn't seem to be the case. Maybe we should start the other one at the same time just for fun. Okay, the light is flashing on the drive. It's possible because of write caching that the write is going to be pretty slow. Really, we want to look at the read speed here, because that won't be affected by write caching. So the blue light there is flashing, and this has got a green light which is just on. So presumably it's doing the test. It's just not going to tell us about it till later. In the meantime, we can set this up, this thing in here, without accidentally shorting out this business. Okay, the light's flashing a lot now, the blue light. That one's still. Oh, look, here we go. 1.6. Okay, so that's on this drive, whereas this one hasn't yet to show anything. Yeah, it's a bit difficult to try and compare them at the same time because you really want something that can get them both ready to go, and then when they're both ready to go, launch the reads at the same time. Yeah, look how slow that write is. That's disappointing. Wow, look at that. That's a lot better. But probably because this one's not happening at the same time, maybe we can. It's too late, is it? Testing method has fallen through a bit. Thinking, oh, maybe then we should do a file copy test. But then you got the issue of where to and where from. And put a little bit of this tape there, just so that doesn't damage the tracks that are there, since it will be slightly touching. And get that screwed in. Okay, now we've got to get sorted out of power. Probably means making up a cable because well, this will only be picking up the 12 volts because it will get the 3.3 volts through this. Yeah, with thick tracks on the other side of this board that look like they're pulling from the 3.3 volt rail, so that will be coming through to the card. There's no 5 volts on PCIe, so it will just be picking the 12 volts up from there. So we need to make up a little adapter to bring the 12 volts in, and we use this 12 volts thing that's running this at the moment. Yeah, so this test hasn't worked there because we can't get these to occur at the same time. Ah, maybe this is that the number of times it runs it? Test count. Okay, maybe we change it back to 1 gig and do it 9 times. 1 gig 9 times. See what happens. Well, just remember what those results were, and then we'll see if something happens here when they're running at the same time. Fans spinning up in the computer. Oh, look at that. Fairly similar, but is that. I don't know if that's exceeding the max speed of 40 gigabits or 32 when for the PCI, because I thought that was a total of 3.7 gigabytes per second. Well, it looks like we got them to read at the same time this time. Perhaps what we should do is only test the lower one, since that's the faster drive, and then see if it gets better than that. I don't really care about the write test because it's not going to test it hard enough for us. So we got 2.5 there. Maybe what we should do is start up another one of these, and we'll do the F again. That's already chosen it. And it doesn't really matter how many times we do it. Okay, the default's 4 gigabytes anyway, we're doing a 1 gigabyte. So this will just be that drive by itself rather than at the same time as the other one. It's the same. So the second drive reading, well, it's actually less. The second drive going at the same time didn't impede the speed of that fastest one. So there you go. Well, what have we learned here today? Can't have more than one of these on the computer at a time. And maybe these two Thunderbolt ports on the GPD WinMax 2021 edition gets possibly full bandwidth per Thunderbolt port. Maybe. Shame I don't have another higher performance drive available to test. Problem is I put that really high performance drive in the computer. Really high performance. We can check it just for fun while we're here, which is D, which is the bigger partition on the internal drive. We'll do it a fair test, 1 gigabyte. All these drives are fairly well used, so they're probably not performing as they would have done when they were brand new. Hey, look at that. That's, yeah, no messing around there. Okay, I've dug up some information here. The Kitio website, it says for Thunderbolt 3 at around 2.7 gigabytes per second, 2750 megabytes per second is what you're going to get from Thunderbolt 3. So this here was pretty much using the entire bandwidth of one of the Thunderbolt ports. So when we were running this other drive at the same time, it must have had its own bandwidth on its own port. So we can probably say with some confidence that on this GPD computer with the 11th generation CPU, that each Thunderbolt port does get all or more than one Thunderbolt ports worth of bandwidth. We can't really tell here whether it's actually is definitely full bandwidth each, because I don't have a second drive that's fast enough, but we can at least say it gets more than just one port's worth of bandwidth. Very good. It's important to know that these NVMe enclosures only work with Thunderbolt. You cannot connect them to a normal USB port or a USB-C port that does not have Thunderbolt. It won't work. It needs the PCIe that comes from a Thunderbolt port. So I've now got the both of these drives connected up to a different computer. This time it's a Lenovo X1 Yoga Generation 3, which has a 8th generation i7 processor, the older type, where, as far as I know, the Thunderbolt controller is separate. So we should see on this one that the total bandwidth that's shared between these ports is limited, which is different to what we saw on the computer with the newer CPU. So let's test it. Unfortunately, this has Windows 11 on it because I was trying that out and realized what a bad idea that was, but that's going to disappear soon. But for now, I'm going to use it to run the test. There's an F drive and H drive there. Go run them both at the same time. See what happens. Some lights flashing. So the speed is quite a bit slower here. Before we had 1.6 on that top one and 2.4 on the bottom one. We should run the bottom one by itself to see if that can even achieve the speed that it achieved on the other computer. Okay, I think we've seen enough of that. We'll stop those. Clearly, the total Thunderbolt bandwidth available is a lot less on this computer. Let's just run the faster drive. See if it can achieve what it achieved on the other computer, which was 2,400. No. So even just a single drive running on this computer can't achieve the same speed that it could on the newer computer. Even with the other drive running, it could achieve faster than this one can achieve with just one. So there you go. Don't buy an old computer if you expect to have decent Thunderbolt speeds. So this means if you want to use eGPUs, external graphics adapters connected through the Thunderbolt ports, you are much better off going with the 11th generation or newer CPUs because you're going to get a lot more bandwidth on the Thunderbolt ports. Fairly sure it's the 11th generation where they first integrated the Thunderbolt controller into the CPU. I'm not sure if the previous ones had that. I have to do some research, or you'll have to do some research if you want to work it out for your computer. Anyway, that's pretty conclusive. The older computer is nowhere near as good. Let's check running a PCIe card out of one of these. Here it is! Got the NVMe adapter with the PCIe adapter in it, and then we've got video capture card here, and that's the input we're currently using. Suppose we can test that by pulling it out briefly. There you go. There you go, and then on this one we've got Nintendo Switch, so we can put that on. Input 2, and there's that. So you can use this for adding your graphics card or other PCIe card to your computer with the help of one of these adapters, but the fairly dodgy thing is that you need to have an external 12 volt power supply coming in, and ideally you'd have a power switch FET type thing in series with that. That's controlled by the 5 volt or maybe the 3.3 volts coming in from here so that the power sequencing is somewhat controlled. Because, yeah, it's a bit dodgy. I plugged this in, then that, and the card came up okay, but I don't know if cards are, if they're all going to be that forgiving. It depends whether the card even uses the 3.3 volts that comes in. They probably do. It'll probably be at least running the PCIe bridge chip on this one. Anyway, I think that concludes our look at these very reasonably priced NVMe adapters. And it looks like it's a mixed bag. Some only support thin stuff, some support thick stuff, and they might not give you the springs to help secure heatsink on top of the drive, which is disappointing. And they also don't give you any of this stuff to thermally connect your drive to the heatsink. It's also a bit disappointing, but I guess for the price, half the price of the competition of this type of device, it makes it worth it. So anyway, that might be useful to somebody, maybe. See you next time.